Welcome to the Bliss Cafe and Grill, where we talk about stuff that's completely important, such as the Bliss body, which is something that hasn't really been talked about at all for quite some time. I remember back in the 60s and 70s, there was some talk of it. And what we need, all, you know, the song, All You Need Is Love, actually, all you need is the Bliss body, which replaces the emotional body. The Bliss body is immortal. It can't die, it can't be killed, it doesn't deteriorate, it's not born, it doesn't die, any of that. But it's not eternal because it's still a hypothetical, it's still a symbol, and it will be set down at some point. But once you exchange the emotional body for the Bliss body, it's the last body that you have. You don't have any more flesh bodies. You don't need to have any more flesh bodies. If you incarnate, it's the Bliss body incarnating and just putting on a meat suit. But there's no more emotional body associated whatsoever. The emotional body comes from judgment. The Bliss body comes from non-judgment. Comes from God's non-judgment upon all hypotheticals. So, welcome to the show as we go over stuff that's like mind-blowing, completely mind-blowing. But in my case, that's what's happening. That's why my emotional body collapsed. It's at the end. I experienced the end of the emotional body, and I realized that it can't go any farther. It ends up in this deadlock, a stalemate. It doesn't know the truth. It's a stalemate. And then we have to realize that it's time for the Bliss body to come in. And there are people who've had the Bliss body here in this world. Absolutely. That's the goal. We have to have this Bliss body, subtle body. This physical body is just like a monkey suit, a meat suit that goes over the subtler bodies. The metal body, I believe it can stay. Because it's just sort of, it's able to follow reason, it can align with the Bliss body, but the emotional body, no, the emotional body is unstable, it's unstable. So it's been an amazing day of just observing this, how I'm vetting the whole situation and coming to understand it. But here comes the Bliss body, absolutely. It hasn't come in yet, but it is on the verge. So we can talk about that here. And we can also watch a few videos. So, pull up a chair, get some snacks. Have some snacks here, some chips. Have some seltzer water, and we'll take a look at some of the videos. Practice some affirmations. Talk about the Bliss body, and who knows what else we'll talk about, right? Because everything is fair game. Of happy Jesus. Now is concurrent with time. The Bliss body of God is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The Bliss body of non-judgment is mine. Claim it. Say, get used to it. See, the mental body can get familiar, can understand. Understanding means familiarity. It means, oh, I understand that. It means, oh, I'm familiar with that. So, bringing up the Bliss body and talking about it, we get familiar with it, and then you can say, oh, I understand that. So it seems like my mental body understands it and is accepting of it and saying, yeah, I understand that, whereas the emotional body just ends up in this gridlock stalemate where it's not certain. It can't tell one way or the other what is true and what is not true. So, now is concurrent with time. The Bliss body of non-judgment is mine. Now is concurrent with time. The Bliss body of non-judgment is mine. Body of Christ, the rebirth. Jesus says a man cannot enter into the kingdom of heaven unless he's born again. That means exchanging the emotional body for the Bliss body. One must have the Bliss body, which then enables the continuity issue to be resolved. Entirely resolved. And so one dwells with, instead of an emotional body, one dwells with a Bliss body. And the bliss body is not unstable. It's not up and down. It's not dependent on conditions. It doesn't become conditioned by nature. It's not reactive. It's steady. It's calm. It's peaceful. It's steady. It's blissful. And it's that way 360 degrees, time, all time, all space, all things. It's the bliss body. And it's something that we need right now. That is literally what we need. We need the bliss body in this world. As many as possible need to make the exchange of their emotional body with the bliss body. You don't quite get that explanation in the world these days. Again, it used to be something that was talked about, actually. That shows how far we've fallen. What's happening is the emotional body is getting stimulated to an extraordinary extent, which is why I don't like to watch the news or entertainment or much of anything, because it is now just whipping the emotional body into a fervor. And that is a very bad thing. Very bad thing, because people don't understand the exchanging the bliss body for the emotional body. So what really happens is the emotional body ends up in this stalemated condition where it then becomes extremely vulnerable to demagoguery, roboticism, stuff that it wouldn't ordinarily not go for. So the world is intentionally being whipped up into an emotional frenzy by all these various extremely polarizing and contentious issues that don't really need to be pursued the way that they're being pursued at all. It's done being done purposefully. Kind of get the world to be hysterical. The world is going into a state of hysteria, emotional hysteria. And just feeling like they just has to succumb to death. Well, the bliss body has no such problems like this. Bliss body has no such problems. Now is concurrent with time. The bliss of non-judgment is mind. The bliss body doesn't get whipped up into a frenzy. It's steady, steady. It's unconditioned. Nature doesn't affect it. Instability doesn't affect it. Steady like a rock. That's why Jesus said, I'll build my church upon a rock. He meant the bliss body. Bliss body is a rock. It's totally steady. He said, build your house upon a rock, not upon straw or sand or mud or something, upon a rock, a stable foundation. Except that you are born again, you cannot enter the kingdom of heaven. Meaning you must have a... When we say being born again, we think, well, you have a new body, right? Yeah. But it's the bliss body that we need to have, and that's exchange for the emotional body, and the physical body doesn't have to die in this exchange. Physical body doesn't die in the exchange of the bliss body for the emotional body. I almost died yesterday, but not quite. You know, I didn't feel like I was going to die, but I felt like, oh my gosh, I feel almost dead. So just like, wow. My emotional body felt dead. It felt like it had just seized up on me, locked up, stalemated, and just was stuck, couldn't go any further, just couldn't figure things out one way or the other. It's so torn between truth and lies, and doesn't know who to believe, and it's just so apologetic because it wants to believe truth, and yet at the same time lies seem plausible to it, and the poor emotional body just cannot decide at all. It's just horrible. And I said, you know what, it's time to take that burden off the emotional body, which is based on judging between illusions, and let's bring the bliss body in. Now is concurrent with time, the bliss of non-judgment is mine. Now is concurrent with time, the bliss body is mine. So at least we need to introduce the idea, so we're talking about it, that there is such a thing as the bliss body. Subtle bodies, the mental, we say, well, there's the etheric body, and the emotional body, the mental body, the causal body, various subtle bodies. The bliss body comes in, and it smooths everything out. Everything becomes steady, steady state, equal vision. It's what we're looking for in this world during these times that we live in, where there's an intentional attempt to sabotage this planet, drive this planet into just emotional hysteria by, again, many, 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 many means. And they're all being employed right now. So it is absolutely time for the blessed body to arrive upon the scene here in this world. Arrive upon the scene in this world. So, I'm doing my part. You do your part. Your part is as much as possible. Do as much as possible. Get familiar with these concepts, because it's super, super, super important. Realize that the world has been in a free fall for the last 50 years. Free fall of distraction. A free fall of emotionality. We've had our emotions played upon in the most terrible, terrible ways. That has made it extremely difficult for us to focus in on what's really important. But if you're able to watch these videos, you're at least getting exposed to what's important. And you're hearing about it, and you're saying, okay, I'm starting to understand. I'm starting to understand, which means starting to get familiar with it. And that's what counts. Familiarity is really the key. It's so strong, so important, so important. Take someone that doesn't quite grasp something, but is very familiar with it. Again, somebody who can grasp it for a moment. The familiarity is the key. You say, you know, I've covered this territory. I feel comfortable here, and I can keep on going. That's the tortoise. So we can take a look at this other video here. There we go. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time. Now this video depicts the crucifixion of the emotional body. It's a symbolic. It's Jesus in the, I call it sad Jesus. You know, it has all the suffering and misery, etc. The crucifixion of Jesus. And it really depicts what's going on in the world right now. The emotional body can, as it were, die. We can replace it with, exchange it for the bliss body. And then that would be the resurrected body. Christianity is super symbolic, actually. And we've lost the symbolism of it, which means we've lost the real essence of it. So it's become kind of superficial. Didn't used to be superficial. See, ancient people spoke in symbols and parables and pictograms and signs and symbols. And all the artwork, the Christian artwork, it was super symbolic, down to everything. The placing of everything in the picture, the gestures of everything, the colors of everything. Every last bit of those paintings had symbolism that the people read it like a book. Keep in mind that most people throughout history were illiterate, and yet they were super observant. I know people who are illiterate, and their powers of observation are absolutely incredible. It makes us look like we're blind. So they notice something in like a holistic pictogram type of way, where they look at something and they see everything. They notice everything. Whereas we, so used to words and reading, we if it's not a book, we don't really see much. So, but the ancient people, boy, they really read life like a book. And so you have all these very highly symbolic aspects of Christianity. Christianity was never meant to be a linear teaching, okay? This is something that's very important to know, to point out. So the Christianity we have today that everybody's trying to digest and then they regurgitate and digest, it's just trying to turn it into some linear explanation. It doesn't work. You lose it. It was never meant to be taken, and the way the modern people are taken as some sort of linear situation, verbal, conceptual, linear teaching. It was a deep, symbolic, pictorial kind of teaching, holistic gestalt, something that really worked on the emotions. And so we don't have that anymore. We really don't have that anymore. Not anything like it used to be. What we have now as far as linear teaching, Jesus gave out another teaching to help us right now, because we've lost the marrow of Christianity, and so he gave out A Course in Miracles, which is a more linear type of teaching, which was extremely helpful for the problems situation that we're in, because we just started, the wheels started falling off as far as understanding the truth embedded in the Christian symbology. And so we began making all sorts of very silly extrapolations. And so A Course in Miracles reached us as where we are in the modern world, enmeshed in linear explanations and psychological explanations, and laid out the same basic teaching, but in a way that we can really, really relate to. And I cannot relate to the Christian symbology the way that I know the old Christians did. No way. No way, no way. I mean, they simply, some of the ancients had just amazing depth of recognition of all this. But for me, it's just like, I don't know. It's like a comic book. I just don't get it. But I do get the course, A Course in Miracles, very, very, very well, very clearly. You know, it's just it's like my cup of tea, and I think it's the modern cup of tea. So when people put Christianity down, they're putting down the modern modern understanding of it, which is really off the mark. A lot of foolishness. But again, let us not throw out the baby with the bathwater. Just because we have gone into the age of unenlightenment, as it were, the modern science and technology age, and no longer are able to interpret the extraordinary symbology of Christianity, doesn't mean that somehow the teachings are no longer valid or the truth is no longer true. It just means we need a new form, new format, and Jesus gave it out. He knows what's going on. This is someone who absolutely knows what's what. So again, the message is, don't throw out the baby with the bathwater. And fortunate you are if you don't do that. At the same time, you don't have to accept the silly explanations, of modern silly explanations of the Bible story and everything that happened there, because it's highly, highly, highly symbolic. Everything is there, put there for a purpose. And there's a ton of numerology, just a ton of all sorts of stuff that is for those who have the eyes to see and the ears to hear. And Jesus said he has to speak that way back then. He said parables, had to speak in parables and all this oblique symbology. He said, there will come a time when I can speak directly to you, directly. And that's what A Course in Miracles is very, very direct. Super plain, just super direct. It's like, this is what it's all about. This is what it's all about. But even there is still room for a greater depth. When you write a book, you can't put everything into it, because the book would be never ending. So you have to have some emphasis. So not everything is going to be in there by any means. I mean, the bliss body, talk about the bliss body, is not really in there. But that is something that throughout the ages has been known about, understood, and talked about. The bliss body. The second birth. The being born again. Being born of the Spirit. Jesus said, you're born of the water, that's the physical birth, but you must be born of the Spirit to enter the kingdom of heaven. The Spirit is the bliss body. Being born of the Spirit means It's exchanging the emotional body for the bliss body. And that's certainly what I've been working towards my whole life, and continue to work towards it. It's probably why I'm so tired right now, going through crisis. And I made one last big attempt to appeal to the emotional body. It sort of was a gesture of goodwill and a farewell gift by beautifying my surroundings to an extraordinary extent, but it exhausted me, totally exhausted me. Because the emotional body, we've had that for so long, It's hard to say Auf Wiedersehen, and not until we meet again, this is it. And but that's okay. That's something that has to be worked through, and it's not easy. It's not easy, but it's not overwhelmingly difficult. Just have to keep plugging away, and adjust to the end of an era. The end of your emotional bodies. The end of an era. It's the end of your own personal cycles. Once the bliss body comes in, that's it. You are liberated. You are free of the cycles of the flesh, birth and death and rebirth. You're free. You're absolutely free. It's over. It's finally over. The bliss body is the last body you'll ever have. And again, you can have that one as long as you want. It's immortal. The body, whether the body dies or not, it doesn't affect the bliss body in the slightest bit. That's why those like Ramana or Nisargadatta, they have cancer, the body has cancer or whatever, and they're experiencing the bliss body. So to them, it's like nothing. It's like a shadow. The physical body no longer causes trouble. There's no emotional body there to react to it, to suffer. There's no suffering like in the emotional body, no more suffering. Bliss body doesn't suffer. It's just a factual thing that the physical body is going to drop off, but they know that their real body that they have now, their true body, the final body, is the bliss body, and that remains. So that's why, even though you can't see these great teachers in the flesh, they're still in their bliss bodies, and people, they can't appear to people in the form of their bliss bodies, which can look very similar to their flesh bodies. So they're not dead. The bliss body doesn't die. It's not subject to death. Or it's not subject to impermanence, except for the fact that eventually it set down along current with setting down all what ifs. But in the context of what ifs, it's permanent. Because it's the symbolic expression of God's perfect non-judgment upon all hypotheticals. So that's what the bliss body is. So it's the end of death, essentially. It's essentially the end of death. When the bliss body comes, it's the end of death. There's no more dying, no more suffering. The dropping of the body is there's no trauma, there's no suffering, there's no sense of death there, because you know that what is living is the bliss body, and that is your body. And so you're not losing your body. you're just shedding like a t-shirt or something. But the bliss body remains. It's just that physical eyes can't see it, unless it wants to be seen. In some circumstances, it can't be seen. That's why you can have a guru sitting, the flesh body is sitting in somewhere, someplace, and someone else can, 1,000 miles away, they can appear to somebody and help them out, talk with them, whatever. They're in their bliss body. The bliss body's traveling. It's a bliss body that can travel instantly like that. Whereas in the flesh body is still someplace else. Bliss body has all these capabilities. So, but it's not subject to, it can't be attacked, it can't be destroyed, it can't be harmed, anything like that. That is the born again, being born again of the spirit. And it needs to take place while you're here in this world. So, certainly, it's very helpful to become aware of this. Now, I'm not saying it's an easy path. It's not. It's not. But it's a path that can be taken and can be, the goal can be reached. I really feel that way. So I'm just kind of hanging in there right now. Waiting for the bliss body, you might call it, waiting for the bliss body to show up. Making affirmations, very important. Instead of trying to get all emotional about it, I just make affirmations, mental affirmations, just saying, stating what's taking place and my acceptance of it. Here comes the body of bliss. I'm in full acceptance of this. Here, the bliss body arrives and nothing needs to die. When the bliss body arrives, nothing needs to die. The emotional body doesn't die. It's more like an exchanging of one for the other. It's not an attack or a triumph or death or anything like that. It's an exchanging of setting down judgment and picking up non-judgment upon all hypotheticals, which is God's non-judgment. The emotional body is our attempt to do a workaround, try to fix the continuity problem for ourselves. That's what the emotional body is for, and we can't do that. Whereas the bliss body is God's resolution of the continuity problem. So what we're really doing is setting down our ineffectual efforts that don't work in exchange for God's effort, perfect effort, which works perfectly. That's in effect what we're doing. So let us go back here. Now it's concurrent with time. Bliss body is mine. Now it's concurrent with time. The end of death is fine. Now it's concurrent with time. The end of death is fine. Now it's concurrent with time. The bliss body is mine. Now is concurrent with time, the end of suffering is mine. Now is concurrent with time, the end of death is mine. Now is concurrent with time, the end of death is fine. Fine with me. Fine with the mental body. The mental body says, that's fine. No problem. I understand it. So the mental body has a certain understanding. And a familiarity can say, yeah, I'm familiar with that. It's not a problem. I understand what that's all about. So I don't feel mentally overwhelmed by the notion of all this. Otherwise, the mental body would say, oh my gosh, emotional body, you can't leave me, you can't leave me. I depend upon you. Whereas in this case, I say, no, emotional body, you, I don't depend upon you. For clarification. Sometimes you cheer and applaud, sometimes you boo and hiss, and you're swayed one way or the other because you really don't know what's true and what is not true. Easily moved by plausibility, just as easily moved by plausibility as by truth. Whereas the bliss body knows only truth. God's perfect judgment, non-judgment. God's perfect non-judgment upon all hypotheticals, regardless of the form they take. Now is concurrent with time. bliss body is mine. Now it's concurrent with time, bliss ends death, and that's fine. Now is concurrent with time. Now is concurrent with time, meaning God gave the non-judgment concurrent with the rising of hypotheticals, concurrent, same time, same instant. The end of death is fine, the bliss body is mine. Is concurrent with time, the bliss body is mine. You can practice that. Now, it doesn't mean the bliss body is going to instantly replace the emotional body for you. It's a question of getting your mind used to the idea. Get your mind used to these high ideas, these effectual ideas, these productive ideas. We're talking about productivity here. What is truly productive is the ending of hypotheticals. That's what's truly productive. We've kind of had a period where there's been an extraordinary lull in Christian saints. I mean, it's just amazing if you go over Christianity and all the saints in recent times, last couple hundred years, it's just like dropped off a cliff and they're scrounging for anything they can get. It's just ridiculous. I mean, technically, a saint is one whose bliss body has replaced the emotional body. That's a saint. And if that hasn't happened, then one is not a saint. And in the recent history of Christianity, is there anyone can point to where the bliss body actually replaced the emotional body? I can't find them. It's now the bar has been lowered down to so-called miracles while they're living, like somebody got well from, you know, in some way associated with somebody, some sickness receded, then after they're dead, also someone prayed to them, they got well, and things like this, you know, it's just ridiculous. I mean, there used to be some real saints in the world. And people know what they're talking about, but recently, holy cow, which I think is a lie, why a lot of people in the West gravitated to Eastern teachings, because there were still some saints. I mean, look, just look at the saints in the East, like Hinduism, for example. In that tradition, you had Ramana Maharshi, and you had Anandamayi Ma. Then more recently, you had Punja G, and you had Mayor Baba, and you've had Nisargadatta Guru, Sri Nisargadatta, and you've had. Then there's just, you know, there's a whole bunch of them. There's a whole the Indian Ram Dass, and Krishna Bai, and you know, have these. These saints who have bliss bodies. And so, of course, when you're serious about this bliss body and salvation, you want to know where the juice is. Where are the saints? Where are the saints? Where are those who have bliss bodies? Where are they? I couldn't find any here in the West. I really couldn't find in particular. I mean, there's some that are not so well known, like Marie Watts, who was quite extraordinary. You have like Joel Goldsmith, who I'm not exactly sure what the case was in that situation. Mary Baker Eddy, not quite the situation as in the Eastern great gurus. Franklin Merrill Wolfe, you know, and of course the modern ones right now, you have various teachers in the West like Adyashanti and Buddhji and Eckhart Tolle and Ganja G and a lot of different teachers. Eckhart Tolle talks about the pain body just suddenly, poof, you know, gone, and in his place is a Bliss body. So he seems to be talking about that, but time will tell on that. But that there's a very strong similarity between what he's saying and what's being said here is the Bliss body replaces the emotional body. He calls it the pain body. The pain body is dropped away, which is very possible, very possible. He said he suffered this horrendous depression, and then suddenly, boom, pain body just dropped, collapsed, gone. And I tend to believe him. How well he understands it is another question. But definitely, the idea of this sudden feeling of just a horrendous depression, I experienced that yesterday. And the night before last, just absolutely terrible. The emotional body was absolutely bereft, just in the most terrible grief imaginable. It was just horrendous. It was so, emotional body spoke to me just apologizing, saying, I'm so sorry, I just can't, don't know who to trust. I just can't come to a point of trusting you or anything. I just don't know, I can never do it. I'm so sorry. It was just, emotional body was just in a state of utter, complete anguish. And I was just observing it and saying, wow, that's really not good, you know. And then I woke up in the morning and I felt like my emotional body had just like died. I just felt terrible. And I've been going through this crisis. So it's probably similar to that. And Eckhart Tolle talks about how he was depressed for a long time and a lot of troubles. And then finally came to a crisis where it just felt this horrendous pain and suffering, and thought he was going to die, and then it just dropped away. So that could be a case of the Bliss body coming in, but you know, well, time will tell, hindsight will tell. But yeah, I mean, I tend to give him the benefit of the doubt. I tend to give Eckhart Tolle the benefit of the doubt, and he's having a lot of attention. He's very intriguing. Has a very intriguing persona, to say the least. Part of it is just like no one's ever really seen anyone like that. Has that kind of quaint personality like that. It's just people get a real chuckle out of it, and it just has this very different kind of persona. And that's attracted a whole lot of attention. And it's attracted the attention of course, those who say, hey folks, don't worry about exchanging Bliss body for emotional body. We'll explain it to the emotional body so the emotional body can understand it, and that'll be good enough. You know, you get those interpreters who tend to be doing that, taking profound spiritual teaching and then stepping it down so the emotional body can understand it, which is not the point. It's not the point. What the point of spiritual teaching, wait for this plane to, the point of spiritual teaching is to get the mental body ready for this exchange. So here in these videos, we're not really talking to the emotional body. We're talking to the mental body. We're talking to the causal body. We're talking to deep clarification, so that there's a familiarity and a preparedness for this exchange, so that the Bliss body can come in. And we say, yeah, sure, welcome. We're expecting you. Come aboard. We're expecting you. The Bliss boat. Soon we'll be making another run. Come aboard. We're expecting you. You say, come on, I'm expecting you. Come on, everything's fine. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Glad you're here. And goodbye, death, and all this stuff. And the mind says, sure, I'm expecting it. That's what one needs to do. That's what speeds up the whole situation. You cannot prepare the emotional body for the bliss body, because the emotional body is going to be exchanged for the bliss body. And it's a basket case. I mean, right now, my emotional body was an absolute basket case. It surprised me, really. I was very surprised. What in the world is this? It feels like a complete failure. And it is. So how can you prepare anything to be a complete failure? That you can't solve it on that level. You have to have some part of you, aspect of you, has to be still in charge and still functioning. See, I'm yesterday, I was like a dead person in the daytime, and what kept me going? My mental body kept me going. I was just running on fumes. My mental body, my emotional body was like dead, collapsed. Couldn't function at all. It was just unbelievable. So I just kept functioning. I taped yesterday. You see the tape is right there, the one before this. And everything seems normal to everybody. Look at me. Everything seems normal. But I sure didn't feel normal. I still can hardly walk. And I'm so shaky and unsteady emotionally. But nobody has any idea, because my mental body is okay with it, saying, okay, I understand what's happening. I'm not panicking. I'm not running around telling people, hey, you know, I feel terrible. Something's going on. I don't know what's going on. And trying to ask people's opinions, which is a disaster if you do that. It's a disaster. It's just making affirmations like, that's great. Bliss body, I'm waiting for you. Come aboard. I'm expecting you. Come aboard. We're expecting you. So come on, bliss body. Come on. Come aboard and let's set sail. And let's the bliss boat. So hopefully it will play out. It sounds like Eckhart had a like nice little, nice tidy birth, you know. Didn't even need any midwives, just overnight. Yeah, it took place, and woke up in the morning, everything, all the emotional body was gone with the wind. So that's a very fortunate quick birth. Not everybody has that kind of easy birth, as it were. So when you hear these gurus talk about this situation, it's because of enormous preparation ahead of time, enormous preparation. And they finally make the exchange, and the exchange can happen very quickly. The bliss body for the emotional body can happen very quickly. In my case, I don't know when it's going to happen. I hope it happens soon, because I'm like just wiped out. I'm definitely in a different state than normal, as far as my nervous system and everything. I stand up, I'll just feel like, whoa, almost tipsy and just and weak, and my head kind of pounding like this, and just shake, just feel very, very different, like something. And if you can misinterpret it easily, say, oh, I'm coming down with something, I'm getting sick, but no, my mind has trained itself to not interpret these situations as some sort of illness. I've had many episodes through the years where the emotional body is more and more attaching, so to speak, getting ready to be exchanged. It's been a long process, and it seems like you're getting sick. You think, oh, I'm coming down or something terrible, I'm going to die. And I say, no, this is just part of the process, don't worry about it. And then it goes. And this time, I don't know if this is the final episode or not. It could be. Wouldn't be surprising if it was. I had a dream a while ago where this like area right here was like a huge black knotted mass here, all twisted and scrunched up, and suddenly all the kinks and knots were undone, and it sprang out to I don't know, just infinity or something. It was gone. This whole mass here of tangled knottedness, poof, suddenly, just like that, in a flash, it was all gone. And that's talked about too. Like they talk about the granths or adi granth or something, that the knots, there's some Sanskrit word for it, and that they can, the knots can suddenly be released like that in a flash, all gone, the complex is gone. So I would think this may have been holding the emotional body in place, and when this suddenly all the entanglement knots were suddenly released, gone, then the emotional body followed very quickly after that. I had this, you know, having these symptoms. But again, my mental body is untouched by this. It's untouched. I'm just observing it. But boy, do I feel weak and feeble and tired. And can I summon up emotion for something? Not really. Not really. I don't feel depressed or anything like that, but it's just the only emotion I'm feeling is it would be anxiety. There's some anxiety, like, whoa, what's going on here? There might be some anxiety in my body, in the etheric body, the physical body. It might be reacting to something. So hopefully the bliss body gets here soon. It would be a help. It'd be a help to people for sure. Be a help. That's what the world needs. The more bliss bodies in the world, the better. Super helpful. Super helpful. But it's certainly not something that anyone you can force. You absolutely cannot force it. No way in the world can you force this. No way. You're going to be in trouble if you try to force it. I know some people try to be spiritual athletes and try to raise kundalini and do this kind of nonsense. That's a big mistake. Can't force it. It's kind of like a birth. You just have to let it take place when it's ready to take place. And in this case, you try to force it. You're gonna have a breakdown. You're gonna have a breakdown. You're gonna end up in a mental asylum. You're gonna end up on antipsychotics, or I mean, you're gonna end up with suicide, or all that stuff is possible if you try and force it. Which I tell people, don't force it. Don't drink caffeine, don't use caffeine products and stimulants and drugs and stuff. No, 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 no. This is something that you need mental clarity to handle. And you need real mental clarity to handle. And you really have to work at it in a relentless way, without trying to force anything, but really, really, really familiarize yourself and be comfortable with it. So that you don't panic. Because what can happen is if you're not prepared and you try to force it, you definitely will panic. And you simply will end up going off the deep end in some way. I can see that. I was just viewing today, observing all the different reactions I'm having, and realizing everything is a wrong step at this point, except for the bliss body to arrive. Everything else is a wrong step. So you're literally in a situation where everything is a wrong step. Well, virtually everything. Sitting here taping might be a decent step, but that too could be a wrong step. I don't know, but it feels like everything, almost everything, is a wrong step, and it's only going to result in terrible troubles and difficulties. Imagine if you felt that in your life and didn't understand what was happening to you. Wow, it'd just be absolutely horrible. You couldn't take it. You could not take it. If you jumped into my shoes right now, you would freak out, absolutely freak out. But for me, there's no freak out at all. There's no sense of that is possible at all. And there's no overwroughtness. The mind is calm. Mind is calm. It's not trying to force anything. It's just observing and just saying, okay, maybe I can come up with an affirmation here. Let's see if we can't move things along. It's kind of like labor pains. You just have to endure them. I have to take frequent rests. I lie down and just poof, out like a light. Sleep for an hour, sleep for 2 hours, and then get up. And I could go a little bit longer, then my battery runs out. This morning, I felt so tired after like 4 hours of work. I was suddenly so tired. Wow, like I got no juice. It's a funny thing that the battery for this laptop suddenly completely died like several days ago, concurrent with this collapse of the emotional body. Same time, my battery literally has no more juice, can't hold any charge whatsoever. So when I move my computer, I have to unplug it from the wall. The computer instantly dies. So I had to order a new battery. It hasn't come yet. At the same time as this collapse, feeling like I've completely run out of energy. I can't hold any charge at all. Which, like, my emotional body just can't hold a charge at all anymore. Cannot hold it. I can't charge myself up with energy. It's impossible at this point. Which is rather frightening. You know, there again, if you think that's your life, it's a very frightening thing. I have hope that the bliss body will arrive, which will then change the whole scenario. But if you didn't have that clarity about that, you would feel like panicky, completely panicky, because you say, I can't function this way. It's impossible. My life is basically over. I can't do anything. Can't function. I'll be completely exhausted, and there doesn't seem any reason why. Doctors, of course, wouldn't be able to find anything. And you freak out. So don't try to get rid of the emotional body. No, it's not that. The way is to welcome the bliss bodies. Focus on welcoming the bliss body. Don't try to demonize, attack the emotional body at all. Don't try to welcome the bliss body, saying, come aboard, we're expecting you. Now is concurrent with time. It's a, God, I appreciate, understand your perfect response to what ifs. That was a concurrent response, and that was absolutely perfect. And so I unreservedly accept your remedy for the continuity problem, which is the bliss, the arrival of the bliss body. Unreservedly, without any reservation, I fully embrace the arrival of the bliss body. You can go about it that way. That's a better way to go about it. Don't be focusing on the emotional body. Focus on the bliss body and making affirmations that you're expecting and welcoming its arrival. Because you know that this is the God's resolution of the continuity problem, which is the only problem that we could presume to have. The only problem that hypotheticals have is setting down hypotheticals. Continuity issue. And so we welcome the resolution of the continuity issue. We welcome the arrival in our lives of the resolution of the continuity issue. And it's a permanent resolution. We welcome the permanent resolution of the continuity issue. And it happens to be in the form of this bliss body. Body of bliss. In other words, a body meaning it's with you. You feel it's part of you. It stays with you. Just like this physical flesh body, it's always with you, right? So we say, this is my body. We say, it's a body because it's always around you. It's always with you. Well, the bliss body arrives. It's always going to stay with you. It's going to be with you. Yogananda marveled at Anandamayi and said, it's amazing because she has this bliss. Wherever she goes, the bliss is with her. And it never leaves her. Never leaves her. No matter what, talking, walking, in meditation, no matter what she does, it's all the same. The bliss body is still there continuously. Because that she didn't have an emotional body. She had a bliss body. And Yogananda said, most of us need to meditate to touch upon the bliss body to get close to it. But in this case, it's there all the time. So it's like it is a body. It's like a garment that we're wearing, a body that we're wearing. And so we let's see if we can get that. Is that going to go? Yeah, okay. In this crucifixion of the emotional body, as it were, the body's nailed on the cross. What happens when you're nailed on the cross? You can't move one way or the other, right? So the emotional body feels like it's crucified. That's what I experienced 2 nights ago. That my emotional body was entirely crucified on the cross of uncertainty. And I felt like I was there at the foot of the cross, just looking up at the emotional body and observing it with some feeling was, well, it was the mental body, so it was just being observant and seeing clearly what's going on, just noticing what's going on, and seeing the anguish. There was just this incredible anguish there. Gosh, I don't want to try and relive that, that's for sure. And you see this, the anguish depicted here with Jesus Christ. And right there, crucified. That's how I felt. Emotional body was like that, where it's just can't decide. It can't figure it out. It just cannot do it. And I've been talking emotional body. I say, don't worry. The bliss body will do it. Don't worry. No worries. So who knows? They laid Jesus in the grave, and then after the dead emotional body was dead, and then after a while he was resurrected, and what happened? The bliss body came into the picture. So maybe there's a period of time between one and the other taking place. I don't know. We'll see. Now, concerned with time, exchange the emotional body for the bliss body. The bliss body is now mine. Exchange the bliss body. Exchange the emotional body. And now the bliss body is mine. Make the emotional body exchange, and the bliss body is mine. Now it's concurrent with time. That's the key to it. That's the key. That's seeing that. When I saw that, that God had acted perfectly, properly, and justly in addressing the what if hypotheticals that Spirit, Son of God, entertained. What if God responded to that perfectly by concurrently passing perfect non-judgment upon all what-ifs, eternal and perfect non-judgment upon all what-ifs. And it was done concurrently, and I saw that it was absolutely correct, right thing to do, and then I accepted that. I said, God, that you did exactly right. I accept that. I absolutely accept it. And I give you, forgive myself, all is forgiven, because I see that you did the right thing. So, and from that point on, there's this rapid situation develop. It's important to note again that the mental body is untouched by this. Feels exactly the same. No difference. So the capacity to communicate is untouched. The capacity to use words is untouched. But the emotional strain right now is just is completely off the charts. Now, in Jesus' case, it was symbolized as it happened quickly, very quickly, very quickly. So it's a different kind of death. The other, you see, everyone was so surprised, like, huh? How could he die so quickly? He has a clue. They're talking about the death of the emotional body, or the exchange of the emotional body, the ending of the emotional body. Whereas the those two on the side of him, they lingered and had a normal crucifixion death. Whereas Jesus was just, gave a shout, and that's it. And that's it, boom, suddenly gone, wow. And then the resurrected Jesus was very blissful. Depicted as very blissful, super assured. And to them the same, they said, "Oh, you speak the same." And yet there's a radiance about you. But his ability to communicate was not changed. Communicate just fine. Showing the scar means showing that where the emotional body, quote unquote, was a symbolic. And saying, yeah, it's the same me. It's just I exchanged the emotional body for the bliss body. This is something that was acted out, or at least it's written that way to symbolize, to show us what we need to do. What we need to do. And the mind should work towards that, get used to that. Say, work with the Holy Spirit. And get very clear about why. Why does this need to take place? And again, we're not trying to bring it about directly. It's just something that comes about when one is ready, because of the work, the clarification that they've done, that it's just something that is bound to happen. But I never aimed for this directly at all. In fact, it's kind of a surprise. It's been a long, long, long time since I've even thought about this. I used to think about it, and I just pretty much just stop thinking about it and just put your head down and just work, and whatever happens. Now is concurrent with time, the peace of God is mine. Now is concurrent with time, the bliss body is mine. But hasn't happened yet, in my I feel, as if part of me is like a corpse right now, really. It's like there's part of me that seems to be dead. Part of me seems to be dead. It seems like some kind of death, as it were, took place, or dissolution or something. It doesn't seem to be getting any better. Doesn't seem to be, which is why I feel that this may be, it's on its way out, very possibly. And there's absolutely no mystical symptoms whatsoever. None. It's entirely just felt physical, the severe malaise kind of feeling. Nothing mystical at all. Everything's the same. It just feels like part of me has just dropped, collapsed. And so the rest, I have to just make an effort to keep on going. Kind of missing the energy factor. So, very interesting. And yet again, don't push the river. I don't feel like I can push the river at this point. Just have to somehow it. Most people, if you had this, you go to the doctor and say, "Doctor, I feel like I'm coming down with a flu, or I feel terrible." And the doctor will say, "Well, here you go. Take some of this cold medicine or flu medicine and some aspirin or whatever, painkillers, and take some bed rest, and call me if it doesn't get better." And you know, that's it. They'll check you out. I say, "Well, we don't find anything wrong." So what's the use? What's the use of going? I never go to doctors. Because I know what I'm going through is the spiritual path, and the stuff I experience is not illness in the sense that doctors are relevant to doctors at all. It's not really illness. It's a process of making the appropriate exchanges. And in doing so, you go through various malaises on the spiritual path, which are well known throughout history, but these days we've lost sight of that. You know, the great tragedy of modern times is that we've lost sight of the wisdom on the spiritual path and the help and the reinforcement of that. As you go along, you have these troubles, and knowing that helps you get through it, knowing that what to expect. If you're going in for surgery, ask the anesthesiologist to say, "Hey, doc, you know what's going to happen? How am I going to feel?" And the doc, a good one, will tell you, "Hey, look, you know, you're going to feel like you got hit by a truck when you wait after the first couple of days, and then you'll feel like you got hit by a car, and then maybe by a bicycle, and then eventually you'll feel okay, but you're going to have, you know, very bad sore throat, put a breathing tube down you, and you're basically going to feel very miserable." So at least, you know, when you know what to expect, say, "Okay, I'm experiencing this. No reason to panic. This is what I'm supposed to be feeling, and I just hang in there and wait, and gradually I'll feel better." Same thing on the spiritual path. You go through difficulties, and you realize, okay, this is I'm working on this issue of exchanging the, you know, going towards that, and in doing so, I run into some inner anguish and severe fatigue and types of depression and go through all sorts of temporary difficulties, but they fade away. Even you can have some physical ailments that show up. And when they do, I always say, this is just a reflection of a deeper situation that's resolving itself, and it's temporary, and I just have to keep working on the deeper levels, and this illness, physical illness, the symptoms will go away, and they always do. They always melt away without taking any medicine, going to the doctor, doing anything. They melt away. And because I would focus 100% on the inner process of clarification, and in doing so, it would resolve itself. Now, not theoretically, everyone can do that. Theoretically, that's the problem with Christian Science, problem with mental healing, all that stuff. It's theory. It's correct theory. But not everybody can handle it that way. They're not ready to. those who are mature can. They can. And any illness they have can vanish rather quickly without any sort of treatment except affirming the truth. Which is what Christian Science does. It just basically, it simply affirm the truth. The practitioner and the one being healed affirm the truth. And in affirming the truth, it takes all the juice out of the illness, and it dissolves and vanishes. But quite a few people simply are not ready for that. And so you cannot apply that technique to everybody at this point in time. So the empirical, you know, Western medicine is needed for those who need it. I've had so many situations I know the interpretation was, hey, you know, you're going to be dying if you don't get this taken care of by a doctor. You got to go in. I just say, no. Mental body say, no. This is some emotional issue that's working out, and we'll just work it through here. No problem, we'll get it. And it always works. But if you aren't able to look at it that way, then it could turn into a full-blown severe physical problem that needs medical attention. Absolutely. So you don't have to have a rigid view of stuff. You have to see the bigger picture and realize that, you know, some people are in kindergarten, some are in college. You can't apply the same techniques to kindergartners as graduate students. And this is wisdom, and this is what's been lost in the world. Wisdom has been lost in this world. It's almost extinct. Because of that, it puts this burden on teachers. Like Eckhart Tolle is like, he's kind of saying, hey, come and get the contact high, and that should do it for you. Because there's no good tradition for him to teach within. The wisdom traditions in the West have broken down. The people are unaware of them to a large extent. And it's just, what can he say? How's he put it all in context? He's pretty much stuck with what he's doing. It's a sign of the times. Same thing with Muji, a satsang, and pretty much stuck with the way that it is, of kind of bootstrapping the situation. Whereas in the past, I mean, when I grew up, I was aware of traditions that the path was well known, and it was a lifelong endeavor, and it was well known the difficulties that you would have, and all that was expected, and the context was still there. I was kind of still aware of that, but it was getting fainter and fainter, like streams in a desert disappearing. You had the new thought, the science of mind. You had a lot of different Western traditions, Christian Science, and a lot of traditions like that. Like I mentioned Marie Watts, who's just incredible. I don't know what she looks like or where she lived or anything about her except her books, which are hard to find. I think one of them just got republished. She's amazing. Clarity that she has, absolutely amazing. And of course, you know, the traditions like Joel Goldsmith was part of tradition that these people had an understanding of the path and the traditions of the high traditions, high Christianity traditions, and the great mystery traditions of the difficulties that are along the way, and putting it in context, and the necessity to work at it and keep working at it, etc. But all that has again evaporated, gone with the wind. So the modern people with their dumb phones and Twitter accounts and everything, it's like, hey, well, yeah, we want to be enlightened. What do we do? I just feel like I want to be happy. You know, how can I be happy? What are they going to say? They say, well, here, just sit here and maybe it'll happen for you. Maybe it'll happen for you. Well, maybe and maybe not. But it's not really getting in the fullest context, because the problem is we've lost the thread. Civilization, society has lost the thread. Technology really knocked it out. Really knocked it out with the advent of computers and such. It really got knocked out, because people say, hey, we got all these toys. It's like children, suddenly having all these toys showered upon them. It used to be the children would be playing, just riding a bicycle maybe, and doing a lot of contemplation, etc. And then along come all these toys, and the children just go, oh my gosh, forget all about, you know, what they were doing before. Forget all about it. And, I went through that. I did an unbelievable amount of work with graphics and stuff like computers and stuff that way. It's just like, wow, incredible, the visuals and graphics and stuff that I've seen and created on computers, actually. And it's like mind-blowing. But eventually, all this gadgetry wears off. I had all this mixing and editing gadgets, equipment, recording studio, yeah, everything, but eventually just like, wow, this isn't it. But because so many, this generation, couple generations is now really completely inundated with that, they spend their time doing that instead of being truly informed about the wisdom traditions and the path and how it goes. So the thread is lost, it's knocked out. So what do you say? You say to people, come see me and maybe you'll get a contact high and maybe you'll get it. Yeah, maybe you'll get it. And maybe not. And they have retreats and they try to reestablish some sort of wisdom tradition. But I guess if you're not directly part of that, it's invisible to the world as a whole, really. It's very difficult to, it used to be much more visible during the 50s, the 60s, the 70s. Now it seems like it's kind of vanished. And as if it didn't even exist. But I imagine there's some teachers in the world who are very much under the radar developing their satsang and their situation and helping us out. But it's become very, almost invisible. And so that makes it difficult because, unfortunately, I was born early enough so I could tap into the wisdom of all that before technology made its arrived upon the stage. And basically, I just ignored technology as it came on the stage, living here, right here, near where Apple was created. And all that stuff, we family got an Apple computer, it was there, we played little games and graphic stuff, and we'd use the word processor, whatever we could do, and traded up to a better Mac, that kind of thing, and then, so it was there, but I realized that this isn't it, but at the same hand, it's something that we're going to have to go through, so I kind of put myself through it all, realizing this isn't it, but you don't want to. You want to realize it's not it, and not be pulled down by it. So here we are at this point in history, and I'm able to just dismiss it, say that's not it, and it doesn't matter what gadgets come out. It doesn't matter anymore. Really doesn't matter. That's why the dumb phone for me. Why? That stuff just doesn't have any attraction anymore. So that's positive. Whereas those who really haven't kind of vetted it, they still think, wow, maybe if I just, get the next thing, and the next thing, and the next thing, and the next thing. Chasing the dragon. I already did that. Always chasing the next version, the next version, the next version. It's like, after a while, oh my God, this is terrible. But that was secondary to the underlying awareness that there is a spiritual goal that can be reached. And that was always taking place, always working on that. So here we are now, where technology is about to make its big splash. It's about to put the hammer down, and so it's time to step into the get the bliss body here, time for to make exchange. So at that point, there, whatever happens doesn't cause any ripples at all in the bliss body. You cannot throw any stones into the bliss body and cause any ripples. You cannot. Calm. A preternatural calm. As Jesus said, a peace beyond understanding. In other words, understanding means beyond what we're familiar with. A peace beyond what we are familiar with. The world is simply not familiar with that peace and can't understand where it comes from because it's not conditioned. It's not, doesn't seem to be coming from any process of nature. Does not seem to be coming from there. So, these are the times. What is it, March? Coming up to the end of March. There's no question that this rest of this year, look out. You will need contact with bliss body. You know, you will need it. The world will need it. I've been saying that over and over. Now, I've said that I think maybe a guru, a great guru, will come back, but what is that? That's just the appearances of a bliss body in this world is what it really is. And it could also mean that I'm going to exchange the emotional body for the bliss body, too. It could mean that. It could be one or the other or both. But the general principle is the same, is that we need bliss bodies in the world right now, need it, because they're like super calm, super calm. You've never experienced that, believe me. When you come across a bliss body, it is something else. Even in pictures or videos, if you come across it, it is something else, and you know right away this is something else, and this is it. This is really something. You say, this is what I really want. I can tell. Okay, I think I'm going to wrap this up now. Yeah, very great. Let's see what happens tomorrow. Let's see how the night goes. Okay, very great. That's it.